In 2017, a U.S. postage stamp was dedicated to Father Theodore Hesburgh, the longtime president of the University of Notre Dame. The Postal Service citation called him one of the most important civic and educational leaders of the 20th century. In our century, his story is somewhat less well known, but a new documentary film has set out to change that. NewsHour Weekend's Christopher Brooker has more.
It was the job Father Ted Hesburgh didn't take that perhaps best illustrates the reverence in which he was held.
There was a point in time where he was actually asked to run NASA. He turned it down. He didn't think that that was maybe a great fit for him.
He advises presidents.
He was a mythic figure.
Confers with the Pope.
We heard these stories about this legend.
He is chairman of the Rockefeller Foundation.
My God, how many lives did this man live?
He is Father Theodore Martin Hesburgh, president of the University of Notre Dame.
In the late 20th century, very few people held as much behind-the-scenes power and exercised as much influence as Father Ted Hesburgh. He served on 16 different presidential commissions, helping author and champion some of the most transformative legislation in American history.
We call him the Forrest Gump of America in the later half of the 20th century.
Patrick Creedon is the director of the documentary Hesburgh.
He was this person who sort of somehow popped up all over the place in our society, and everywhere he showed up, he was able to sort of get the tough jobs done that needed to be done. He was never a president. He was never a U.S. senator. He was never a prominent news figure or anchorman or anchorwoman. He was the guy behind the guy.
Now, you yourself attended Notre Dame.
Yeah, we kind of crossed paths for about a year there. I never met him, but I'd see him on campus, and I certainly knew his reputation, and I knew that he was a major figure on the American landscape. But being a documentary filmmaker, I always have a little bit of a skeptical eye, and I really wanted to sort of see for myself if his work really lived up to his reputation, and it did.
Hesburgh's journey started as a young college president hoping to transform his university, an effort that required money, which Father Hesburgh was particularly adept at securing through donations. Throughout the early 50s, his network grew ever larger, and soon the president of Notre Dame would meet the president of the United States. What would start with an appointment to the National Science Board in 1954 would lead to an appointment to one of the most consequential commissions in U.S. history, the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights, a group tasked by the president to research civil and racial inequality in the segregated South.
We are trying to create one nation. It could very possibly be that we are verging through our institutions towards two societies, one black and one white, and that wouldn't be America, I don't think.
While Hesburgh championed civil rights, he was also an advocate for free speech and the exchange of ideas, even if those ideas clashed with his own. In 1963, a campus group invited Alabama governor and segregationist George Wallace to speak at Notre Dame. The very same George Wallace who, in 1958, had threatened to throw Hesburgh and the other members of the Commission on Civil Rights in jail if they visited Alabama.
A kangaroo civil rights commission set up in this state for the purpose of intimidating and harassing the citizenship of this state for purely partisan political reasons.
Despite student protests against Wallace's visit to Notre Dame, Hesburgh allowed the speech to take place. But just 1 year later, the work of the Commission on Civil Rights would be part of a major transformation of America.
My fellow Americans, I am about to sign into law the Civil Rights Act of 1964.
On July 2, 1964, President Lyndon Johnson signed the landmark Civil Rights Act, outlawing discrimination based on race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. Father Hesburgh was called the architect of the law. But the coming years would be challenging for Father Hesburgh, as student protests against the Vietnam War expanded throughout the country.
He wore a lot of different hats, and those jobs that he held were oftentimes in conflict with each other.
The most natural thing I could do here today is talk about student unrest, but I suspect most of you have it about up to here, and I have to admit that I have had it up to here also.
Reverend Theodore Hesburgh today announced a get tough policy. Father Hesburgh said demonstrators will be given 15 minutes to halt their protest. If they don't, they'll be suspended on the spot. If they do not halt within another 5 minutes, they will be expelled.
Your film paints a portrait of Father Ted being on the right side of history for nearly everything except student protest.
Yeah. There's a real nuance to that. Father Ted believed that that a campus was supposed to be a crossroads of different ideas. He wasn't against protesting. He was against violent protesting or the kind of protesting that would impede someone else's education. And so back in 1970, they ended up expelling five students who had blocked the entrance to job interviews that were taking place.
With the CIA and Dow Chemical.
The CIA and it was Dow Chemical, two very unpopular groups during the middle of the Vietnam War.
But just over a year later, Hesburgh would become a very public critic of the war in Vietnam. After four students were shot and killed by the National Guard at Kent State University in Ohio during protests against President Nixon's expansion of the war into Cambodia.
There comes a time in life, in personal life and in national life, when moral righteousness is more important than empty victory.
His speech became known as the Hesburgh Declaration and was signed by 15,000 students and residents of South Bend. Hesburgh sent it to President Nixon in May of 1970. Hesburgh's relationship with Nixon was fraying. A few months later, he and the Civil Rights Commission, against the president's wishes, published a report that detailed the government's slow implementation of civil rights legislation.
Here is the first complete study ever made of the whole federal establishment as regards at least civil rights compliance and how we're delivering on what the law says we should do. It says the performance is pretty poor, always has been.
You were asked by the White House to delay this report until after the election.
They were concerned about the timing, and we didn't share their concern as to the political importance of the report.
Nixon fired Hesburgh from the Civil Rights Commission in 1972.
I think President Nixon had no idea that Father Ted was going to become one of his most hard-hitting adversaries. And I think as history went on, I think Father Ted actually kind of wore that as a badge of honor. He lost his job, but he kept his conscience.
As a viewer, I did find myself waiting for, are we going to get to the Catholic Church sex scandal?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. It's worth noting that Father Ted retired in 1987. So in some ways, the story of the scandal within the church really kind of missed Father Ted. He just simply wasn't a part of that conversation. That's one of the great regrets I have for Father Ted's story, is that I wish that he was engaged in that conversation and in that problem.
But Father Hesburgh's retirement years weren't silent. He was still consulted and called upon by presidents. President Bill Clinton awarded him the Congressional Gold Medal, one of the highest civilian honors in the country. And in 2009, when protest erupted before President Barack Obama's visit to Notre Dame, it was Father Hesburgh who reassured the school's administration that hosting a pro-choice president at a Catholic university was the right thing to do.
Differences of culture and religion and conviction can coexist with friendship, civility, hospitality, and especially love.
Father Hesburgh died in 2015 at the age of 97.